Hello everyone, welcome to Botanical channel for UPSC examination. In today's video, again we are continuing the series, that is the agencies of pollination, and in this third video we are going to see the entomophily. In the first two videos we have seen the anemophily and hydrophily. In this particular video we will only focus on the entomophily. Entomophily is nothing but the pollination with the use of insect as a pollinating agency. So the insect will be the prime focus of this video. So before starting the video, I request you to join the Telegram channel of the same name, that is the Botany Optional for UPSC examination. There we regularly upload the PDFs of this video and links of the video so that you will not miss any update relating with the Botany channel. So let's learn about the entomophily. Now first of all, what is meant by entomophily? This word entomophily is made up of two words, that is entomon and philly. This entomon word literally means insect and philly means loving. That is, those plants or those flowers which are insect loving are called as entomophilous plants or entomophilous flowers, and the concept is called as the entomophily. Pollination through the agency of insect is called as entomophily, and plants are called as the entomophilous plants. That is, if the pollination is occurring by with the help of insect, then that pollination is called as the entomophilous pollination, and in such a plant where there is the entomophilous pollination occurs, it is called entomophilous plants. And those are flowers which shows the entomophily are called as the entomophilous flowers. The example for this entomophilous plants is rose and jasmine. This is a very common type of pollination because most of the pollination occurs with the help of insect. And as you can see in these four pictures, the different types of insects are used to pollinate the flower, such as butterflies, moths, bees, beetles, etc. All these insects are used for the transferring of the pollen grains from anther to the stigma of the another flower in order to get the pollination done. So the entomophily is nothing but the pollination by using the insect as agency. Now let us see which are the common insects which are used in the entomophily. Now the insects which are commonly used by the plants to get pollinated are moths, butterflies, beetles, flies and bees. But remember, about 75% to 80% of the insect pollination occurs with the help of bees, and rest shows the 10 to 20% involvement in the pollination. So you should carefully remember that there are many insects which are used in the insect pollination, that is in the entomophily, such as the moth, butterflies, beetles or flies, but the bees are main source of the insect pollination, that is 75 to 80% of the pollination is occurred through the activities of bees. So while writing down the answer about the entomophily, you should mention the insects like moth, butterfly, beetles and flies, but you should not forget to specially mention the bees, because most of the times bees are responsible for the pollinating the flower. Alright. Now let's consider the floral adaptations for the entomophily. That is how the flowers are get modified in order to have the insect pollination, that is the entomophily. There are certain features developed by the plant flowers which attracts the insect in order to get pollination done. We will see these adaptations one by one. See, the first adaptation is that entomophilous flowers are the large and the attractive. As you can observe in this particular picture, the entomophilous flowers are very large. That is, they have the large growth, plus they are attractive. You can see there are various colored flowers which are very attractive, and that is why insects get easily attracted towards these flowers. So this is the first adaptation, that the flowers are large and attractive. Sometimes the flowers may be small, and if the flowers are small, they produce in a group or say inflorescence. So majority of the time the entomophilous flowers are large, but if the small flowers are there, the flowers will be produced in a group or say in the inflorescence in order to get recognized in the nature by the insects. Alright. The flowers have attractive bright colors, pleasant fragrance and the nectar. Now this is a very important point, that the flowers of entomophilous plants are very bright colored. You can observe these are very bright colored flowers and they have very pleasant fragrance. As you know, most of the flowers shows the great variety in the fragrance, and the fragrance is quite remarkable that it attracts insects from the kilometers away. At the same time, these flowers also contains the nectar, and due to the presence of nectar, the insect gets so much interested in these flowers that they do not miss any flower in the locality. That is, they land on the every flower to get the nectar, and in the process of getting the nectar, the insect transfer the pollen grains from one flower to the another flower. So this is a quite great adaptation which is shown by the entomophilous plants, that they produce flowers which have bright color, pleasant fragrance, and they at the same time have the nectar. All these things are very attractive for the insect, and that is why these are plants able to transfer the pollens from one flower to another flower by using the insects. Then there are some additional modifications such as corona in the passion flower and petaloid bracts in the Bougainvillea. As you can observe in this third diagram, this is a passion flower, and you can observe the corolla of the passion flower. It is so beautiful and attractive for the insect. Now, this is a special adaptation developed by the passion flower in order to attract the insect towards this flower. So in a passion flower, we find the corona, which is very attractive, and that is why the insects get attracted towards it. In the Bougainvillea plant, the petaloid bracts are very beautiful, which are again very attractive for the insects. Then the next adaptation is the pollen grains have the rug and the spiny exine. That is, the pollen grains of the Entomophilous plants have the very rug and spiny exine. That is, you know the shape of the pollen grain. This is nearly the circular, and it is very spiny in the Entomophilous plants. Now, what happened? What is the advantage of having the spiny exine? Is that whenever the insect land on the flower, these spines able to attach to the legs of the insect, and once they attach to the legs of the insect, they will remain attached there due to the presence of these spiny exine. So this spiny exine is used to cling to the legs of the insect, and in this way, this pollen grain gets transferred from one flower to another flower when that insect visits the another flower. Alright, so having the rug and spiny exine provides a great evolutionary advantage of transferring pollen grains by using the insect. The next floral adaptation shown by the Entomophilous plant is a sticky stigma. The recipient flower is very sticky, that is spiny or the rug pollen grains when attached to the legs of the insect, and when that insect visits the another flower where there is a stigma, and if that stigma is a sticky, that stigma will catch this pollen grains, and which will be followed by the pollen germination and subsequently to the pollination. So in order to grasp the rug and spiny pollen grains, the stigma is very sticky in the Entomophilous flowers. So all these six are the adaptations which are found in the Entomophilous plants. I have intentionally written down all these on this slide because you can take the notes simultaneously so that you do not have to worry about the notes of the every topic. So make sure to write down all these points in your notebook. We have seen the six adaptations. First is the flowers are the large and attractive. Then if the flowers are small, they produce in a inflorescence or in a group. Then flowers are attractive. They are very bright colored, pleasant fragrance, and nectar is also present. Additional modifications such as corona in a passion flower and petaloid bracts in the Bougainvillea are present. The pollen grains have rug and spiny exine, and stigma of these flower is a sticky in nature. All right. Now, while talking about the Entomophilous flowers, we have to take the special adaptations in the Salvia plant because it is the most discussed adaptations in the Entomophilous plants. That is, it shows the lever mechanism. So we will see in detail how this special adaptation in the Salvia helps the plant to get pollinated by using the lever mechanism. Now see, the Salvia have protandrous flowers. In this particular picture, the flower is protruding out from the plant, and that is why it is called as protandrous flower. Then in the flower, there are two stamens which have the long bifurcated connective. That is, there are two stamens. You can observe in this picture. There are two stamens which are bifurcated by the long connective. Now, the upper branch of the connective bears the fertile anther lobe. The upper branch bears the fertile anther lobe, while the lower branch has the sterile anther lobe. That is, at the lower side, they have the sterile anther lobe, while on the upper side, they have the fertile anther lobe. So this type of structural differentiation is present in the Salvia plant. Now, what is the advantage of this structural differentiation during the Entomophily? Now see, when insects lowers the lower sterile lobe, as a result, the upper sterile lobe bends down. Now see, when the insect visit this flower, they sit on the lower sterile lobe, and when they sit on the lower sterile lobe, they bend down the upper sterile lobe on their backs. That is, when there is a upper sterile lobe of the anther and the lower sterile lobe of the anther, and in between this, if the insect place himself here, then due to the pushing of this lower sterile lobe, this upper sterile lobe bends down on the back of the insect. Now, where it comes in contact with the backside of the insect body, and pollen grains are deposited there. That is, on the backside of the insect, the pollen grains are deposited by the upper fertile lobe of the anther. Now, at the back of the insect, we have the fertile pollen grains. Now, when the same insect visits the another flower which have mature gynoecium, the pollen grains are picked up by the receptive stigma. As you know, when this insect is go to the another flower where there is a mature gynoecium, all these pollen grains are received by the stigma of that flower. And in this way, the pollen grains are transferred from one salvia flower to the another salvia flower, right? So this type of mechanism is also called as the lever mechanism. So you should remember very carefully the special adaptations which are found in the salvia for the entomophily, because these topics are very important from the MCQ examination point of view. You have to write all these examples during your mains examination, that salvia has a protandrous flower, then secondly it has a two stamens and which has a very long bifurcated connective. The upper branch of connective bears the fertile antherlobe while the lower branch bears the sterile antherlobe. Then when insect lowers the lower sterile lobe, the upper sterile lobes comes in contact with the backside of the insect, hence depositing all the pollen grains on the back of the insect. When the same insect visits the another flower which has the mature gynoecium, the pollen grains on the back of the insect is received by the stigma, and in this way pollination occurs in the salvia. Alright, so this is all about the entomophily. I hope you like this lecture. Please like the video. Please share this video with your friends who are studying botany. And if you have any doubt, please make sure to comment in the comment box. And if you haven't subscribed to our channel yet, please subscribe to the Botany Option channel for UPSC examination. Again, thank you very much for watching this video. See you in the next one.